Welcome to this web lecture that describes how current responsible innovation approaches have evolved out of the approach of technology assessment. We will discuss the following topics in this web lecture. First, early forerunners of technology assessment and responsible innovation. Second, technology assessment and its evolution. Third, three current technology assessment approaches. And fourth, responsible innovation. There are two main forerunners of technology assessment, so-called LZ and impact assessment. Let me first tell you something about LZ. LZ stands for Ethical, Legal and Social Implications. LZ started in 1990 as a part of the program of the Human Genome Project. It was aimed at identifying the ethical, legal and social implications of the mapping of the human genome. 5% of the annual budget of the Human Genome Project was allocated to LZ. Impact assessment is another important forerunner of technology assessment. Its history goes back to the late 60s. It aims at identifying the future consequences of a current or proposed action. There are in fact many kinds of impact assessment, some of which are legally obliged in some countries before a project can start. These kinds of impact assessments include, for example, environmental impact assessment, risk assessment, health impact assessment, social impact assessment, and gender impact assessment. Technology assessment is in a sense also a form of impact assessment, and it may be described as an attempt to objectively predict social consequences of new technologies as an input for policy making by the government. In the United States, the Office of Technology Assessment was established in 1972 and it existed until 1995. Its purpose was to provide Congress with objective analysis of complex scientific and technical issues. Although the American Office of Technology Assessment has been disbanded, several counties still have an Office of Technology Assessment. As I said, technology assessment started as an attempt to objectively predict the consequences of new technology for policymakers. However, it has evolved over time, and this evolution of technology assessment can be described as follows. First, there is a development from objective prediction of expected consequences to anticipation of possible consequences. Second, it went from governments to companies and research organizations. And third, where it initially was more reactive, it is now more proactive, and it tries to influence design and R&D, research and development. Today, there are a large number of technology assessment approaches, but in this web lecture, I would like to focus on three of them, and I will briefly elaborate on these three. The three I want to focus on are constructive technology assessment, or CTA, midstream modulation, and what's called a network approach for more evaluation. So, let me first look at the approach of constructive technology assessment, or CTA. CTA was developed in the Netherlands in the 1980s by people like Arie Rip and Johan Schot. And the aim of CTA is to reduce the cost of trial and error learning. It aims to do so by anticipating future developments and their impacts. And the aim is also to feedback these insights into the design of technology. CTA has three more specific goals. First, learning about social consequences. Second, reflexivity. This implies an awareness of the different actors and their positions in the network. Third, anticipation of social consequences. In striving for these goals, CTA also aims at broadening technological development by including more aspects and by involving more stakeholders. Now, one of the tools that's used in CTA is the building of so-called scenarios. Now, the aim of such scenario is not to predict the future, but the aim is to anticipate possible futures. Such futures help to avoid worst-case scenarios. It also helps to better prepare for the future by developing strategies that are robust for different possible futures. Now, let's go to a second current method. This is midstream modelation. And this method was mainly developed by Eric Fieser in the United States. The method is directed at so-called research laboratories, where the new technologies are developed. And the aim of the midstream modelation is to enhance the responsive capacity of laboratories in order to broaden the social dimensions of the work. Now, the term midstream is used to stress that the method focuses on modulating so-called R&D, research and design practices, rather than upstream decisions on what research to fund, or downstream decisions about how to use particular technologies. The method of midstream modelation has mainly been applied to nanotechnology. Nanotechnology is an emerging technology that proceeds by manipulating the properties of materials on the nanoscale. And a nanometer is 10 to the power of minus 9 meter, very small. Now, for example, the National Nanotech Initiative in the United States pays attention to what it calls responsible nanotechnological development. And it also pays attention to ELSI, ethical, legal and social implications. Also, the Dutch NanoNext program pays attention to risk assessment and to technology assessment. Now, midstream modelation, the method implies the inclusion of a humanist. And a humanist, this can be a social scientist or an ethicist. And it implies the inclusion of this humanist at the work floor in the research laboratory. And he undertakes, or she undertakes, a number of activities, including, first, participation, participant observation. He or she asks questions to people in the laboratory. He discusses issues with them, and he gives feedback to them. Okay, let's go to a third approach. And this is the network approach for more evaluation, or NAME. This approach was developed here in Delft. And it starts from the assumption that innovation takes place in so-called social networks. Now, such network might consist of companies, research laboratories, universities, suppliers, and so on and so forth. And the idea of the approach is that we need to trace the network dynamics in order to discern more issues. The approach also consists of network norms to judge these networks. Now let us look at these network norms. The two main network norms in the NAME approach are, first of all, learning and reflexivity. Second, openness and inclusiveness. Now, with respect to learning and reflection, we can make a distinction between first-order learning and second-order learning. Let me explain the difference. First-order learning is about how to achieve goals. For example, it is learning how to improve a technology. Second-order learning doesn't take given the existing goals as given, but is about what goals to achieve. For example, what values should be incorporated in the technological development and design. We can also more precisely define openness and inclusiveness. Openness means that it is possible to reformulate the central issue of the network. Now, inclusiveness means that all the actors and all the relevant considerations are included in a network. So, this NAME approach that I just described, we applied to innovation in wastewater treatment, the so-called NERWEDA. NERWEDA is an innovative wastewater technology, and it won several innovation prizes. It was developed by researchers here from Delft University of Technology and from the engineering firm Royal Halskoning, DAV. The main innovation is that the living conditions of the bacteria that clean the water have been changed. And the effect of this change is that they now grow in granules instead of in flocks. And as a result, the sludge in the treatment will settle quicker, which results in a smaller footprint of the plant. And this is economically very advantageous. Now, in the research that we did, we found that it was not clear in the innovation network who was responsible for what we called secondary emissions. Now, secondary emissions are emissions that are not regulated by the law, but they may nevertheless be harmful. Think, for example, of heavy metals. Now, what we saw was an illustration of what in an earlier web lecture was called the problem of many hands. We asked who was responsible for the secondary emissions. This graph that you see here shows how the users attributed the responsibility to address secondary emissions to the research phase. But on the other hand, most of the researchers attributed this responsibility to the use phase, with the danger that nobody will address it. Now, as a result of our findings, the researchers better looked into these secondary emissions. And in the end, these turned out not to pose a big problem. Okay, to end this lecture, let us look again at responsible innovation. In a recent book, Richard Owen and a number of colleagues describe a framework for responsible innovation. And this framework has four main components. They say that responsible innovation should first of all be anticipatory. This means that it should anticipate possible social consequences of new innovations. Second, it should be reflective. And it should also be deliberative. And this means that it should include a wide range of stakeholders and considerations. Finally, it should be responsive. It should influence the direction of technological development and design by responding to social and ethical concerns. Now, if we look at these four norms, I think one can clearly see that all these four are inspired by or go back to earlier technology assessment approaches that are discussed in this lecture. Goodbye, and thanks for your attention.